and the flap inset. What do you do post-operative?
I want to monitor the flap hourly.
Suction drain, close the neck, suction drain. How many days you are going to keep it? Post-operative monitoring of the flap.
One after the neck dissection. Would like to keep one in the neck and one.
One in the neck then.
One from the.
This is absolutely you will be doing the neck closure and keeping the drain. Oh, okay. Your senior will finish up the anastomosis.
Everyone will run away. Everyone will run away.
This you should know well.
They will say bye bye and they'll run away. I don't do it, but everybody will say bye bye and run away.
How do you keep the drain? Where do you keep the drain? Where exactly you put the drain and where exactly you introduce the drain? Have you done a neck closure?
I'm not sure.
So, what do you think is the principle of placing a drain in a neck, doctor? You tell me, based on common knowledge. Nothing medical about it. Tell me how you like to play. You like to place a dependent drain or an anti-dependent drain? Would you like to place the drain near your anastomosis or away from your anastomosis? Would you like to do a combination of a suction drain and a passive drain?
I would place it away from the anastomosis.
Excellent. So answered one question. So if I want to drain small collections near the anastomosis, would you like to put a passive drain there, a gravitational drain there?
Yes.
Or a capillary drain there?
Yes.
What can that be? Can be a glove drain?
A dependent...
No, I'm saying near the anastomosis can be a glove drain.
Yes.
And then lower...
In the neck,
you can put a suction drain. That's all.
Two drains, one is a glove drain, the other is a suction
Excellent.
Drain.
Yes, that is the answer.
Okay. You know about it.
Okay.
So post-operative, what are your
yeah. How much of dextran will you give the patient?
I hydrate them 5 pints per day.
No. How much dextran? You know what dextran is, no?
Will you give dextran?
First of all, ma'am, don't ask that question. That was to dig her own grave. Would you give dextran to a patient post-op?
I don't know. So
dextran used to be given earlier thinking that it'll expand the plasma and cause better flow into the microvasculature of the flap. But they found that dextran causes a lot of pulmonary complications. We have proved that in a paper from Amrita. There's a large systematic review saying that. So dextran is out of the equation for post-operative flap well-being. It's not there at all. What will you like to have your HB at, your hemoglobin at?
Minimum of 10.
No, I don't know if that's the right answer. I would prefer hemodilution post-op. So as per the American Academy, unless the patient is cardiovascular compromised or the patient has cardiovascular illness, you don't keep the HP at 10, you can keep the HP at 8. Okay. Some amount of hemodilution is acceptable post-op for flap well-being. Okay. And 8 is an acceptable number for patients who don't have cardiac comorbidities or the patient is not old, then 8 is an acceptable number. And what is your anticoagulant policy post-op?
Post-op low molecular weight heparin BD for 5 days.
Sorry?
low molecular weight heparin for 5 days
Are you going to give the DVT prophylaxis, or are you giving some antithrombotic prophylaxis?
Antithrombotic prophylaxis.
No, so anti-DVT prophylaxis is sufficient unless you experienced an unexplained thrombotic event intra-op. You don't have to keep the patient on a thrombolytic post-op schedule. Just a DVT prophylaxis. Clexane is sufficient. If you have an unexplained thrombotic event intra-op, unexplained meaning something not to do with your technique, not to do with the vessel morphology, not to do with the lie of the vessels, external pressure and whatnot. If that doesn't happen, just 0.2 cc of clexane for 5 days is sufficient. But if the patient has an unexplained thrombotic event, you can systemically heparinize the patient. Yeah.
Okay.
So how long will you keep the cast on the radial forearm?
Till the skin graft.
Skin graft will settle for 48 hours if you put in a good bed. So you'll take the graft POP in 48 hours?
No, sir.
When will you take it out?
10.
If you take it in 10 days post-op, you'll have finger stiffness.
give him a night, 1 week
post-op. Yeah, 5 to 7 days post-op is fine. Yes. But you'd always want to give them some sort of splint to prevent distant shearing in the post-op. You know, long-term shearing you want to prevent. You can give a ulnar gutter, thermoplastic splint you can give them so that the skin graft doesn't shear.
When do you start the rails to feed?
Rails to feeding after 24 hours.
And oral feeding?
Oral.
When do you remove the rails to?
Once patient speaks.
Huh?
Yeah.
Once patient
speaks. Like chicken or the egg cancer. Obviously, once the patient takes orally, why would he have a big tube in his nose and going through his throat? So when do you expect mucosal healing and mucosa skin interface healing? When do you expect that to happen?
What?
Usually 5 days. 5 to 7 days you can take it out.
Okay, at the end of 7 days, see your mucosal insert is fine and it healed well, then ensure that, then please remove the rhinostomy. Okay. Okay. Then, when do you send the patient for radiotherapy? Does this patient need any radiotherapy?
Since nodes are positive, he would require, if nodes are positive and there is a tumor margin less than 1 centimeter clearance, then he'll require a post-op radiotherapy.
No, less five. Five is considered clear margin. 5 mm is considered clear margin, not 1 centimeter. So again, your answer should be closed margins, positive nodes, or extracapsular spread in the lymph nodes. So the first two will require adjuvant RT, the extra capsular would require adjuvant chemo RT. That you would know only on, obviously, the final histopathology. Because this is an advanced stage, clinically stage 4 disease, you would always counsel him for adjuvant treatment, correct?
Yes.
And he cannot be left without counseling for adjuvant treatment.
He will require.
Yeah. So what are the ways to monitor a flap post-op?
One is checking the color.
What? Everything will be brown in color. What? Suddenly, if it dies, well, if it becomes black, you can never touch the flap ever again. It's gone to the dustbin after that. What color are you going to say? If you're in a white population, if you are working overseas, you can make out blanching and discoloration and all that. But in our situation, what is the most standard thing that people follow?
Scratch.
Yeah, so you want to see the scratch technique to see for the amount of blood. It should appear in 1 to 3 seconds, bright red, should not be congested, should not be dark in color. Then beyond that, tell me some adjunctive techniques that you can use to monitor the flaps.
Um,
Okay, so if you know the place where the
Doppler.
perforator is, you can Doppler the perforator, or you can Doppler distal to the anastomosis to see for blood flow. That is fine. That is more often used for concealed flaps like jejunum or some buried flap like radial forearm for pharynx reconstruction. The only way is to use Doppler studies to do. What is an implantable Doppler?
I don't know.
So there's a company called Cook. Cook makes implantable Dopplers where you crimp a metal thing around the anastomosis, distal to the anastomosis, and it's connected to a Doppler machine. So it gives you constant Doppler signals to show that the anastomosis is working. So you can have an implantable Doppler. You can have cutaneous SpO2 measurements. You can have blood oxygen saturation measurements. You can have laser measurements. There are many adjunctive techniques which have not been proven to be better than the scratch technique. Scratch technique is the best technique. So if your scratch technique yields good flow, like with bright color blood in 1 to 3 seconds without undue delay, then you know your flap is working. So flap monitoring also is an important aspect of doing microvascular.
So how often you do the monitoring in the
How
hospital?
often exactly? How often do you do the flap monitoring?
Every hour.
Every hour for 5 days, the nurses will run around.
No, for the first 24 hours,
Okay.
then once in 4 hours.
Once in 4 hours, or so. What is your ischemia time that you have available for fasciocutaneous flaps? Do you know what primary ischemia is, what secondary ischemia is? Unless you know very correctly, don't tell me because it won't
I
make any
don't know.
sense.
No, sir, I
Okay.
don't.
So you've re-explored a flap which has not been working,
Okay, sir.
and you have redone the artery,
Okay, sir.
but the vein is not returning blood. What is this called?
Venus.
No reflow phenomenon. Have you heard of it?
Not sure, sir.
No reflow phenomenon. Have you heard of it?
No, sir.
So a no reflow phenomenon act occurs when the flap has passed critical ischemia, when there is damage to the capillary endothelium, meaning that the blood flows into the flap. But because there's irreversible endothelial damage, it does not get transmitted to the venules and then into the vein. So when you have no reflow phenomenon, have people tried anything? Have they tried any techniques to get the flap to perfuse? Heparin only works if you want to prevent thrombus. It doesn't work on established thrombus.
I don't see.
Streptokinase.
See, it is thrombus in the venous system, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, will you, Dr. Benedicta,
Yes,
this
sir.
establish the thrombus management, you should say. Whatever anticoagulant which you give, that is all for prophylaxis.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And how do you, in the COVID times, this is, will you subject all your patients for CT scan staging of the neck, or any other shortcut method is there? Because if you are working in a large volume unit, you cannot send all the patients for CT scan staging
Yes,
of the
sir.
neck. But then, as a cancer, I mean, management and establishment of stage, you require staging, you require some kind of evaluation. So, what is the other modality?
Sentinel.
Do you know ultrasonogram of the neck also can be done?
Yes, sir.
Evaluation for
Yes, sir.
nodes with high resolution probes.
Yeah, if you have
Okay,
three
sir.
hertz or 5 hertz probes, you can very easily do a very detailed analysis of the neck the vessels, dynamic flow through the vessels. That's what sir is trying to ask you, thrombus. So you can do a, you know, a Doppler of the vessels with your ultrasound.
Yes.
And then you can make sure which vessels are patent, which of them are showing small thrombi, or which are showing sluggish flow. That in this COVID time, especially with the way COVID is affecting multi-system and everything, I think an ultrasound is invaluable. Correct, sir?
Yes, Dr. Deepak. Yeah.
I think the ultrasound is invaluable now.
Invaluable. It comes in handy for you, no? Like, yes. Yeah, you cannot subject the patient for CT or MRI, CT, dynamic studies, or all those things. But your ultrasound, you can use a Doppler also. You can image the neck also with ultrasound.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, sir.
One last question. Tell me variations of radial artery.
I'm not sure.
There's type 1, type 2, type 3. One is high brachial origin. One is origin before PIO. Yeah, you have distal to PIO. Have you read that? Or?
No, sir. I'm not sure, sir.
It was actually based on, you know, the cardiology people, no? When they were doing radial catheterizations, they have come up with a classification of variations of the radial artery. I have had in my personal practice two patients who had aberrant radial arteries. There was a persistent median artery in one patient, and in one patient, radial artery was hyperplastic deep to the brachioradialis, and it stopped there. But the artery was quite thick before the intraosseous. So, there is a lot of, I mean, you have to know the arterial anatomy very clearly. If you read some of the articles published by cardiologists on radial cath, you will know the variation. Radial forearm is not a simple matter. If the artery is the dominant supply of the hand, you will end up with a tight job of trying to revascularize, especially because your distal cut of the radial artery will be near the wrist, and yes, then it escapes over the thumb. You will have to slit the skin vertically, follow it up to the thumb, and then try and re-anastomose it. By then, the artery lumen also become very small. No vein graft will fit that. I have had experiences. No vein graft will fit that lumen. Isn't it, sir?
Thing is, this persistent radial artery,
yes, sir.
Persistent,
yes,
radial artery, median artery,
yes,
can
sir,
be,
yes,
used for anastomosis also, even in trauma also. Sometimes
it can, sir. It can.
Radial.
But it's not, yeah, a good art. It's not a good situation,
yeah,
for the flap.
Yeah.
There have been times that we have had to slit the wrist, go up to the ball of the great toe, and then try to find the vessel. But it's not a very positive thing to talk about. People are very indiscriminate about the radial artery. But you just remember that one person can have anomalies of the radial artery. That is very important.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry if this was more abuse than teaching,
no,
or whatever. But this is all I know, and this is my only chance of telling you. So I'm telling you.
This is like a mock exam, so let them face it now, so that it will.
Illa, ma'am. You shouldn't put all your things on them. It's not right, ma'am.
No, it's at least you are making them to read, right? Like it's.
Reading, ma'am, flap reading and all, you can read hundreds. There are so many things to read.
No, what to read and what to concentrate, only they'll understand only.
Cormac and Lombardi, if you don't read, then you'll find it very difficult. It's a big book. E-book is available in many places. I can send you the e-book if you want, but it's a very nice book to read about arterial anatomy of the human body. And
Sandeep, which one, Deepak? Cormac and Lombardi.
Cormac and Lombardi, sir.
Yeah, Cormac and Lombardi is a lovely book.
Lovely book, sir. I have the e-copy. Yeah. Somebody scanned it and gave it to me, sir. That is a brilliant book to read, sir.
Brilliant book. I have the old edition. Yeah.
Same, sir. Same,
same,
sir.
Only.
Nothing has changed.
Yeah.
Same. And then that Perforator book by Blondiel, no, sir. That book also.
Yeah, Blondiel is also a nice book. Blondiel is also
book.
A nice book.
It's a very good book to read for
Perforator
anatomy, sir.
Anatomy.
And then Fu Chan Wei and Erkin. There are 4 or 5 books to read if you want to be absolutely sure of. Cohen's book is there. Butler, Ian Butler's book is there. There's so many books are there to, if you want to focus on, I only know free flap. So if you want to focus on free flap, then there's a lot of textbooks to read. So anyway, the presentation was really good. I have to say that you had presented very well, very confidently. More than you, the credit goes to your teacher.
Yes.
I would tell that. Teacher to teacher, I will tell more than that. The credit goes to your teacher. You are very confident. God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
I'd also like to thank Lakshmi ma'am and Angelin ma'am and Professor Mahadevan who helped me with the presentation as well.
So, this is mandatory, thing, so it's okay. Good. Well done.
Thank you, sir.
Deepak, you can post the Blondie and this one e version of Cormac and Liberty in Plastic Quest so that we can.
I'll do it tomorrow, sir. I'll get
me and Sandeep will get it in this one.
The other one also I have, sir.
Fuchanvi, yeah?
No, sir. Fuchanvi is the other one, sir, where there are four volumes, sir. I will add that.
Atlas of Microvascular. Atlas. I think I have.
Atlas. Atlas of Microvascular. Four books, no, sir.
But trunk nowadays, is
different, breast is different, trunk is different, abdomen is different, lower limb, upper limb, head neck is one. I'll put Sandeep sir and I'll put it in the Google Drive or something.
Yeah, that will be better.
I'll send out.
Ultimately, it boils down to 2-3 flaps, which you do regularly only.
Correct. And then you burn your fingers and fail and then go back at night and do second.
And for people who do regularly microvascular, I mean like high volume unit like yours, maybe you can attempt doing 2-3 extra flaps, but when you do other work also together, then ultimately 2-3 microvascular flaps only.
Actually, sir, that is very true, sir, because these three flaps, ALT, radial forearm, fibula, will serve 99% of our requirements.
Yes.
And it's both sides. So we have two limbs, two hands, two thighs to harvest it from, sir.
Yeah.
But then once you get bored and you want to teach do something new, no? Then you start digging in other parts of the body. that's things, sir.
It's always there. That's always there.
You get bored of it after some time, sir.
Yes.
We did
one temporoparietal facial.
Okay, sir.
For free
the good flap, sir.
For hand, palm or for palm. For palm, okay, we sir. Use. That is okay. Palm okay, is a good flap, I think, because it's not that bulky.
No, sir.
So you can easily.
And how far you dissect the superficial temporal, sir? through the parotid, you dissect it or?
No, just where because.
How far you dissect the flap through the parotid?
No, up to the parotid because we didn't want the vessel was radial vessel I think we used. So. We didn't have much problem. One of the branches of the radial vessel we used. So, we didn't have much issue in
this one.
As far as palm is concerned, proximal palm is concerned. Yeah, proximal palm is concerned. It is a good flap. Basically.
It's a very good flap, sir.
It's a good flap.
Yeah. Even better than your groin flap. Sometimes, most of the times, we use groin flap only as the workhorse flap. But it is not that thick. It is very thin.
I have a prediction for groin, sir, because I like groin a lot because donor for we, tongue and buccal because no donor side mobility. No, sir.
We have not done groin as free flap. We routinely do pedicle groin for hand.
As no? a pedicle carrier,
for hand,
carrier
hand,
for hand.
Hand. For hand, we use pedicle groin only. So when you compare this temporoparietal facial, the temporoparietal facial with the graft is very thin and it looks very nice also postoperatively.
On the palms. Okay, sir. I have not done palm also. I take for tongue and for buccal.
We have not. We don't do all those things.
It is very nice, sir, because no donor site.
Okay.
One line on the inguinal crease.
We should try.
The groin, SIEP is a little stupid, sir, because the perforate is very thin. But if you take groin as a broad groin, it comes very nicely, sir. Only thing so that sartorius dissection is a bit tedious. But once the artery and vein join, it is a brilliant flap to do for tongue and buccal.
Maybe for cheek also it helps, I think. Cheek
very good, sir. Good. No hair, no, sir. No hair in that area at all, sir.
Yeah.
And then the cheek will just drop to the neck, to the facial artery and facial vein for anastomosis.
Mm.
So, I really like groin a lot, sir.
And the size also match will be there, I think.
All will match. And then primary closure with one line on the groin, also happy, sir.
Yeah. We should try, but we have not tried.
I'll put up one video, sir, in my YouTube channel. I've recorded one groin. I haven't edited it. I'll just edit it and put it, sir. One groin and SIEP, both I've done, sir. I'll just edit both and then I will put it up, sir, for sure.
Okay.